So, okay, so this is what I will talk about. So before anything, let's fix some notation. FQ is the field of Q elements, and the point is that there is some ordering of arbitrary ordering of elements. Doesn't really matter. PD is a set of polynomials of degree at most d, univariate polynomials. Okay. So this is some basic notation that let's agree on this. The main problem here. First, I'll tell you a picture of the problem. Okay. So this is a grid. Let's pretend that this is FQ cross FQ, right? And we ordering the field elements a1 to aq, right? The point is that for every ai, I give you a subset ai of the field. So in some like I give you a set of points for every element in the field, right? So for a1, a2, and so on, aq. So they need not be like contiguous or anything. They're just some sets for every element, and you're supposed to find out whether there is some polynomial of degree at most d that passes through these sets. Okay. So this is a function, right? It's one if there is some polynomial that passes through all these sets and zero otherwise. And the point is, of course, the degree must be restricted, because this, as long as AIs are empty, there is some polynomial that always passes through them. Okay. So this is really the problem. I'll define it formally. Yeah, this is the source, as far as I know. I think, you know, it's the only place was ever mentioned. Anyway, okay. So you're given an integer d, which is a degree, and your subsets a1 to aq, and output 1 if there is a polynomial such that on a1 it takes value in capital a1 and so on, like, such that the polynomial is completely contained inside this in these sets. The graph is completely contained in these sets. Okay. It is a function on q cross q square bits to 0 1. This q says that the degree never needs to be more than q. Okay, the problem in Andreev's problem is that show that this is NP hard, and I don't do that here. Okay, so but as a combinatorial function, this is still very interesting too. Okay, so here's a picture again. Like, so the given sets a1 to aq, find out whether there's a polynomial curve whose graph passes through these things. So this is the thing, right? And so I should mention this. It's not really relevant to the rest of the talk, but I should mention that this is closely related to what people do in coding theory. It's like, it's called list recovery. The point is, you fix any query code. And you fix then, so you parameterize it by an integer L, which is an integer, not an alphabet. The point is that I send you a code word, and for every coordinate you give me a subset of alphabets saying, okay, the code word is probably is in one of these alphabets. And the point is, decode it in this fashion. So I guess you can guess that Reed-Solomon codes is what Andreev's problem is related to. And it's kind of an unparameterized, in the sense that I'm not telling you the degree before, I'm not telling you the code, I'm not telling you the L beforehand, and it's a Boolean version. Like, coding theorists are usually interested in when this list size is small, but I just want to see if it's non-empty at all. Okay, so that's some kind of background. Good. So here's the main result, which the title might have suggested. Okay. By the way, we parameterize it too. Like, let's just agree on a degree beforehand. This only makes whatever lower bound stronger, because right. So let's, any questions? Okay, good. So let's agree on a degree beforehand. Now it's just a Boolean function on q square bits, right? And let's denote this by d. And the point is, right, any high touch circuit with AND or NOT parity gates that computes this function must have size at least some exponential and sub exponential in the number of inputs, right? This omega depends on this r. So I'm thinking of r as a constant. Okay, so this is the result here.
Are these bounded?
I'm sorry, no, this is an AC0 parity thing. So there are the parameters by high touch, and I didn't use depth d because there's a decent. Okay, right. Oh, of course, right. So after this, like barely a month ago, Bogdanov told me that there was a paper in 2007, like by Bogdanov and Safra, where the techniques also can be used to kind of do this. But we'll do something related, but something I guess stronger and interesting. So far so good. So let's continue. Okay. So here's some relevant background for this. So this is. Right, so I'm just defining a function. It's a Boolean function on n bits, and I'm telling you that it can solve the p delta coin problem if it can distinguish between coins of bias slightly less than p and slightly more than p. Okay, so that's when it solves the coin problem. Formally, like f, if I give it Bernoulli independent random variables of p of times 1 plus delta, it mostly outputs 1, and if I give it p times 1 minus delta, it mostly outputs 0. Okay. So this is when it is like f solves a coin problem. On the face of this, it does not look too hard. You count and you can probably, that will probably tell you the correct answer. But you know, we are in AC 0 and you can't really count. These things are not really possible here. Okay. Just to make that formal, the majority function does solve the half order 1 over root n coin problem. You need at least 1 over root n, but the point is, as this delta gets larger, as the gap between the biases gets larger, the problem becomes easier, right? So here's another problem, like a tribes function solves the thing with a slightly more biased gap. Okay, it's a slight detour, but what is a tribes function? It's a Boolean function on some kt bits, where t is log k plus some constant. You know, whatever constant will make it solve the half 1 over log n coin problem. And this is how the function looks. It's a DNF. It's an OR of ANDs, and all the variables of every monomial are disjoint, and they're all of the same size. Right? And so this is a tribes function. I drew it like this because it's a height 2 function circuit of linear size. That's and so there has been some like recent work this year by Limayya, Srinivasan, Tripathi and Venkatesh show this one, like if I increase the height to h, I can solve the half comma log n to the h minus 1 coin problem. So ignore this tilde over here. So tribes is an instantiation where h is 2, right, and big O of 2 is 1. So you can solve the 1 over log n gap in the coin problem with this. And I guess for this talk, the extremely interesting second result is that this is pretty much, if you ignore this tilde, this is the truth. Any circuit that solves the half delta coin problem has circuit size at least so much. So you can plug in delta as 1 over log n to the h minus 1, and you see that barring this, everything matches. Okay. And right, this was also independently shown by Chattopadhyay, Tamil, Lovett and Thal. So in pretty much at the same time. Right. So far so good. So the point is that half is not really special. If I tell you this statement, like you can probably prove this without much effort. It's like saying, if I want to create a coin of bias 1/8, I just take the AND of 3 coins of bias half. That's pretty much what's going on here, and half is nothing special. The whole point we need to go to a lower thing is that okay, first anyway, so let's see, we have that any circuit that solves the coin problem has at least a certain size, and we want to show that some function has at least a certain size, and so you can guess where this is going, that this function does solve the coin problem, right. And we need this because this function only works for RQ, for like, you know, we are working over RQ for constant R. There the bias at which it distinguishes lies at Q to the minus R. Okay. So yeah, more formally, rather more elaborately, when you plug in inputs of independent Bernoullis of bias slightly more than Q to the minus R, you get slightly less than Q to the minus R, you get 0 mostly. And if you plug in inputs of bias slightly more than Q to the minus R, you mostly get 1. And you know, you can probably guess that the 0 statement is the easier part. So I guess the main sub point is that is the 1 statement. And this is one of the reasons at least I was very motivated by this even before the technology of the previous slide, that how do you choose such a statement that if you pick a bunch of points at random, you will contain the graph of some polynomial. At that time I couldn't do it, and that was my main motivation for this. Okay, good. So like I said, why restrict ourselves to this case? So it's not known to be very easy in other cases. So for example, why not something like this, where R is something 1 over log Q? Here you would have to show that it would solve the half comma epsilon bias, you know, half is a nicer number than 1 over some poly n. So why do you restrict yourself to this point? And the answer is, I don't know how. I'll get to this at the end, but at the moment I don't know how. Like I can only do if R is a constant. Okay, good. So yeah, we're here. We're at the main point. So yeah, so the zero statement is if you plug in independent Bernoullis of two small bias, you get zero mostly, and if you plug in independent Bernoullis of slightly more than q to the minus r bias, you get one mostly. Okay, so I'll start with the proof sketch. The proof of the first part, and like I said, this is the easy part. Okay, so what do we really want to show is that you pick a1 to aq each containing independently by including each element with probability q to the minus r times 1 minus epsilon, right? So yeah, log. So the point is epsilon is will be 1 over Pauli q. I'll stop kind of showing that as a parameter. Just yeah, but here it's just very easy. The point is right. Let x be the number of polynomials that you the number of polynomials that you catch in this set, and the expected number of polynomials is of course you sum over all polynomials. This is a probability of containing each point in a polynomial, and there are q points in the graph. This is easy, and you know, this is at most one. This is right, and yeah, this is QED. Right, and for the second, okay, yeah. So okay, look. So how would you want to do the second part? Just the idea is one guess would be just to try and compute the second moment, right? But that's no good. The second moment is actually too large. It doesn't. Right, and I guess I can go into this a bit later, but the point is again you can quote unquote made to work, but it doesn't really solve any, it doesn't really give any lower bound. Questions so far? Yeah. Q to the minus r by 3. Epsilon is something smaller than 1. This is small. No, no. Right, right, right. So the point is if epsilon is smaller, it's a harder statement to prove. So here it's 1, which is more than, here it's q to the minus 1, which would be a harder statement to prove than minus 1/3, which is what minus 1 minus r over 3 was. So I mean, so the point is like, yeah, this implies it for q to the minus 1 minus r over 3. That's so the point, yeah, it's right, okay. The second moment is too large, but you can quote unquote make it work, but doesn't, anyway, doesn't solve the coin problem. Okay, question so far? Okay, so here's how the second part works is that you try and count the number of polynomials in the Fourier basis. And what do I mean? Like, define a function f. Define a function f from fq to the q. I should remove the mouse pointer. Define a function f on fq to the q to 0, 1, right? So okay, this looks weird, but what is this function indicating? The, take any polynomial of degree at most d, write down the set of all its evaluations. That's a vector, right? So f is an indicator of all such vectors. And the point is that you add up two polynomials of degree at most d, you get a polynomial of degree at most d. So this is the linear space. So this is an indicator of some linear space, and which we'll call C from now on. Okay, right. And for every ai, let gi be the indicator that xi is an ai. So this is also, so the way I'm stating it, this looks like it's, this is a function from fq to the q to 0, 1, but it really only depends on the ith coordinate. So where there is no confusion, I'll just, I'm not abuse notation, but the point, right. So okay, given these two, x is exactly the inner product of f and a product of gi's, right? Because you want f to be 1 in the sense that your vector should be a polynomial, and every ai should also, xi should also be an ai. That's counting the number of polynomials, right? And what you want to show is that if a1 to aq are chosen by including every point with probability at least something, then this quantity is more than 0. Okay, so the point is that this is just a normalizing factor. I don't care about this. This is really where it's you know, where it's happening. Okay, so this we'll just agree that this is what we want to show is more than 0 and continue. Good. Right. So Parseval. So that's easy. I guess one it's one of these things where the first, if I tell you the first 1.5 steps, it's, the rest is pretty straightforward to work out. And so I guess at least at that point, the weird thing for me was that I was always used to using Fourier analysis to convert a convolution into a product. But here you kind of unfold this product into a convolution, but luckily things work out happily and this is what you get. You sum over all the dual space and it's like as if you're splitting up this GI. Okay. Remember, like C is the space of all the polynomial evaluations. It's pretty straightforward things. Okay, actually time sum normalizing, but you ignore that. It's only the zeroness or non-zeroness is what matters here. Okay. Right, so you remove the 0 part, the one where alpha is 0, which is also lies in the dual space, minus this, everything else. It's a typo, it's actually at least this much. It's not equal to, right, because I don't know the directions of these numbers. Okay, anyway, so what can the hope be? Is that this term really dominates and the rest of it is junk. And I don't know that it's junk yet, so I'll just call it R. So the point is that every GI hat has expected value 0 and you want to understand how this term looks like. So a very natural thing is to just square it and hope the cross terms go away, right? And you want to show this, of course, you want to show this at most this much smaller than the main term, what will be the main term, okay? Right, and luckily that is exactly what happens. So you look at R, any question? No, it's an indicator function of AI. Like AI is a set, right? And whether this coordinate belongs to AI, right? And right. So if you look at this, so because of that, when you square this, you pretty much take the expectation all the way inside, right? So this is what happens here. Okay. And I guess the relevant facts are, you know, the zero Fourier coefficients of sets, how they look like, and you know the non-zero Fourier coefficients of set, how they look like, and really the main sub point is that this is much that is much bigger than this, and so you want to hope that in most of these summands, most of the product is dominated by these things and not these things. That's what that would do it, and yeah, so that's a good thing. And we can do that, and so yeah, so we can say weight distribution of it's one of these things where if I the dual space of so C dual C is the space of evaluation of all degree D polynomials, the dual of C is the evaluations of all degree Q minus D minus 1 polynomials. So these things are well understood and get exact weight distribution as per we want. Okay. Okay, so let's wrapping up. This is small because you know most of the terms are coming from here. And so with high probability that is small, the R itself is small, and on the other hand product of GI hat 0 is large because GI hat 0 is the size of AI, right? And if you pick points independently, the set shouldn't be too small, and that's really what this is saying, and this is pretty much just a standard last deviation bound, and therefore it's large, therefore this is non-zero, and that's it. I'm putting a box, it's the QED. Okay. And sure, it's also that X is what you expect it to be with high probability. Okay, so that's all for this one. Is it okay? Good. So I guess sure, I have a bit of time. I can tell the other results. So the point is that, like I said, this only worked when R was a constant, when the degree was some constant times Q. But it works whenever it you know you can prove it for any R. But you give up on solving the coin problem. You just want a qualitative sharp threshold, and the whole I wrote like something should work in the paper, but I've had time to check since, and it does work. I'll just tell you the proof pretty quickly. Right. So I said second moment doesn't work, but when you put quotes, it works. Okay. So okay, since I have time, I'll. Okay. So point is, why does second moment not work? So you are picking a subset S square, right? You are picking a random subset here, and for polynomials P1 and P2, the second moment essentially involves estimating terms of like this. Like what is the probability that I contain P1 condition that I contain P2, right? But the point is the size of S is something like Q to the 2 minus R. The size of P2 is Q, like a polynomial contains Q points, and this is much bigger than the standard deviation that you get when you pick such a set, and so you've changed the distribution. So what do? You just condition on and then you most of the bigness goes away, but it's not all done. So you have to use the, you can show that the probability of it being non-zero is at least some half, right? And then you say that okay, because it's a symmetric function, all the influences are the same. So by KKL, all the influence must be at least something. And by Russo-Margulis, look here, if the influence is large, the function must be growing pretty quickly at that point, and so it must be close to ones. That is a proof. Okay, and that gives delta some log n. But the point is, it works throughout without any hassle. That's the first result. Other result. The second other result is, so far we've been looking at containing full polynomials. So what if I want to contain only a, suppose I fix a degree and I give you subset, I pick a bunch of random subset, like what is the largest agreement of this polynomial that this subset has? And there is a theorem like that too. If you pick up, if you want to contain a polynomial of degree d in a subset s, then you contain at least so much. I'll explain what this means, but here's a picture. Like you're not completely passing through these sets, but and the intuition is that this is what you expect, not in a probabilistic sense, in the sense that you cannot expect more than this. By union, that's easy to show that you will not contain more than this, and the point is that this is just junk. That is the truth. And that, okay, questions?
You're aiming to cut intersect all the sets.
No, what is the largest agreement with the set can any polynomial have?
No, so for example, you have got sets on the same vertical, which means if it's a polynomial.
It's not two sets. This is the same set. I mean, some part of it is here, some part of it is here.
Oh, like Pakistan, Bangladesh.
This is an example. This was to illustrate that they're not necessarily intervals.
Okay.
Okay.
It looks strange. Both of them.
You know, yeah, you just want to pass through them. Yeah. So anyway, so this is the second theorem, okay? And right, the point is that this goes back to when I was saying I could not, like, does it solve the coin problem? And like, I've asked this question in many ways, but I guess one clean way to do nothing with the coin problem is to ask, what is the influence of this function? This is.
Yeah,